Now, it's easy to assume that the health that we have now will continue as we grow old. Or maybe we look at our parents and imagine that we'll age in a similar way to them. Our next guest is an award-winning medical and scientific consultant and believes there's a need for a how-to manual on getting old. Dr. Doug Wilson, good morning to you.
Good morning.
Lovely to have you in the studio.
Thank you.
I look at my mum and think, if I can age like my mum, I'll be a very happy woman. But do you see people who have aged badly and there hasn't been a need for that?
There's a dramatic study, you know, the Dunedin study, the longitudinal study, where they've been following people for 45 years now from Dunedin. And they have done a survey where they have evaluated the biological age of the individuals, which relates more to how old they really are, their body really is. And these are quite widely accepted measures. They have found when they looked at 950-odd of their 38-year-olds, they found their biological age range from 28 to 61.
Wow.
So in effect, some of them were aging slightly slower than their chronological age, and others were aging substantially faster. So in terms of your aging process and how it impacts you, a lot of that is under your own control. Not all of it, but most of it's under your own control.
When we say age badly, what do you mean by that?
Aging badly means you're aging faster. Mm. So therefore, your joints are starting to give you more problem. Your head's not functioning quite as well in terms of where it's at. You may have high blood pressure. You may have risk of various diseases. And when people look at you, they may think that you are old by virtue of your appearance.
Mm. And we don't want that. We want to feel and act and be as young as we can for as long as we can.
The important thing is to have a healthy life as well as a long one. Mm. We have a lot of people who live long but don't have a healthy life.
Yeah, if you're going to live a long time, you want to make sure that you're up and doing all the things you can. Genetics obviously must play a bit of it. Can we fight genetics, or are we limited by our family history?
For some conditions, we're limited by our family history. But overall, in terms of how well people age, probably your genes at the moment control about 25%, and 75% is your own, your lifestyle, and what diseases who may emerge at that time. So you can make some difference to it, because even if you've inherited a disease, like some people have for Alzheimer's disease, which increases their risk, but the disease doesn't manifest itself until you switch on the genes. And part of that may be governed by your lifestyle.
Wow, that's fascinating. I think everyone would like to be able to stop that from happening, Alzheimer's gene.
Kicking in? That's right. I'm sure they would, but it's difficult. There have been about 200 studies which have been done investigating drugs to treat Alzheimer's. All have failed. So you can imagine the billions of dollars that have been spent on that. The absolute need is extraordinary.
So is there a recipe for aging well?
I think there is. What I've done, if you go through the literature, it's so complicated and there are so many different perspectives people have. Somebody says, if you take this, this will make a difference to your aging. If you inject this, this will make a difference to your aging. But in effect, the recipe is what we put up on the screen there. Mm. You can plan for your future. If you don't know what you face, you don't know what underlying diseases you have, it's very difficult to treat that as a lottery. If you have things you have, like an early diagnosis of cancer, if you have high blood pressure issues like that, if you treat those, you can reduce your risk of dying from them under those circumstances. But then you can intervene in other ways. The most dramatic change you can have of all, after you've checked out your medical things, is to exercise. Now, people say it's a good thing to exercise, but until you quantify that and see how much you gain from it, it's very difficult to say, oh, go on, do some exercise. So here, the basic rules would run a little like this. If you do, say, 20 minutes of moderate exercise a day and maybe 150 minutes a week, you can reduce your risk of premature death by 30%. And there are multiple studies that have shown that. You also reduce your risk of depression and you also improve your brain function. So under these circumstances, as a simple single intervention, that is like gold.
It is something definitely worth doing. It almost sounds like somebody should have written a book about it. Oh, hang on a sec. Aging for the Beginners. Somebody has written a book about it. What do you hope people are going to get out of this book?
Well, because if you look at the last few years of your life, it's like going on a journey where no one's been before. Because in this technological age, you as the individual is being pounded by things that are good for you, that entertain you, that increase your connections and communications. And of course, of those disorders that are going to limit your life, you might as well know what those early warnings are so that you can in fact deal with it. And if you do things like changing diet, get rid of isolation, get rid of depression, then what I've done is try to sift through the literature and work out what is robust information and include that in the book. So in effect, it's like a tour guide for the rest of your life.
Which sounds perfect. You sifted out all the rubbish and you've got the good stuff here. I think, and also people can obviously start doing something today to make sure that they do live a long and happy life. That's been fascinating stuff. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Great advice.
Thank you so much for coming along. Now, if you'd like to get your own copy of Dr. Doug Wilson's book for Aging for Beginners, it has been sold exclusively through Paper Plus Select and Take Note Nationwide.